Another eclipse.
Oh, sorry. Good evening. Welcome, everybody. Actually, let's everybody stand up. If you don't mind, if you want to stay sitting, stay sitting. But if you don't mind standing, let's stand. I think everybody knows this song, so let's sing together.
Seated. Well, good evening. I apologize. I haven't left the property since 7 o'clock this morning, so I was going to run home and try to change, but it didn't work. Couple announcements. The first one I'm going to hand off to Janelle because it has to do with our women's Bible study on Wednesday nights.
Wednesday night Bible study. We'll be wrapping up our Psalms study, and our next week, this will be our last lesson this week, and next week we'll be doing some games and prizes to wrap it up and celebrate, and we'll also be introducing a new study, the Armor of God, and we just welcome all women, whoever's interested, come and see us, and we'll get you a book.
Thank you.
The books are $10.
$10. Perfect. Next announcement is the big one that I'm currently still working on. So just lock in May 19th, which is the church's 48th anniversary. As I said Sunday, there will probably be a focus on Pops, to be honest with you. There will be a focus on Pops. There will be something after the second service. Staff and I, we're working on that right now. So we're hoping in the next couple weeks we'll announce specifically what we're going to do. And then thank you to Gino. I was actually going to text you tonight when I finally got home. Gino is assisting me, if I can throw you under the bus, assisting me with paint stuff on the property. Is that still a go? Good. I just used my dad's routine. Point him out in church, and then they can't. Gino and his crew, we actually have that little thing you told us. We have that ordered and on its way, and we'll get how much paint we need. And I actually have the dates that we're going to start to see if that's going to work for you. We put that together. So a lot going on. Here's the other thing that I would say on a Wednesday night versus mainly a Sunday morning. If you want to be involved in some aspect going forward, and God's calling you to be greeters, or God's calling you to join Ron and the boys, you know, for the offering, please let me know. What we're going to do is after Anniversary Sunday, probably the first week of June, I'm going to have a meeting, and I'll set the night, or I'm going to have a meeting where anybody that wants to be involved, to serve, wants to venture out, we're going to get together because we're going to be preparing to put this stuff in play during the summer. So when the summer's over and everybody's off vacations, then it's full go. And things that I'm discussing are greeting teams, which Dad's tried to put together. Working right now on getting signage for outside. If you want to teach in a Sunday school class, we have amazing people that have been running it, but we also need to work out rotations that people get breaks too. And so that's coming up more. That list is getting put together, and if God's calling you to serve in some kind of fashion, we're going to have a meeting and we're going to plan. Because remember, the people I'm going after are the lost. People haven't went through there, but I'm really going to rely on heavy on the people that have been serving God for a long time to assist me, because my dad was an absolute miracle worker of doing a lot by himself with you guys, but a lot of times it's him. I can't do that. I can't juggle that many. And so I'm looking for more people to be involved because we, like I told the guys tonight, we got to get the baptismal ready because we have kids during the school day, which I get to see. We have kids that their parents came to church on Easter Sunday. They went home and talked to their family, and they've asked me if they can get baptized on a Sunday morning because they saw their parents in church on Easter Sunday. Well, guess what? I got to get the baptismal ready. And so the goal is that we're dunking people quite a bit. Huh? No, we want the full Holy Spirit coming at you. Yeah, exactly.
No,
yeah, so that's one of the things we're going to work on, and just pray going forward. We got a lot of stuff. God has really opened some doors. Recently, we'll have more information on Sunday morning during the 9 a.m. service, but let's get back to singing. Don't forget your prayer cards. Dad, do we have prayer cards back there still? Are they out? Huh? We have about four. So if those run out, we're also going to update those here in the next week. We've got a couple new prayer requests, so we'll have new prayer cards that you can take, put in your Bible. I think so far that would have been, 40 that people have taken, so roughly 36 that people have been taking, and they've been praying for people, which is amazing. And so, but we need to update the list, and so please take one of those. Let's pray, and then we'll get back to singing. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you for an opportunity to come and worship you on a Wednesday night. Lord, we thank you for all of our musicians up on the stage. That Lord, get us going with worship songs to you. Lord, I ask you to be with Dr. Crowe tonight as he speaks, and we'll thank you for it in Jesus' name. Amen. One last announcement, because he won't do it. It's Dr. Crowe's birthday.
Happy birthday, Dr. Crowe.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you.
join us in this one.
Stand to His my Savior. Not me.
Do you know who your Ghostbusters
Am I up?
You're up. Ladies, you can be dismissed. The ones that are going into Bible study.
Janelle, I need a clicker.
Oh, Janelle, do you know
that? Probably.
Oh. It's not usually hiding down there. Okay, it should be working. Welcome, everyone. It's been a while since I've been here, but I'm here tonight. I think I've got a voice. I'm working on it. I left the March 20 date in there just to remind me that it's been a while. And we're going to talk about King Saul tonight, and I have no idea how this is going to go. But then Nahshon the Amorite came up and encamped against Jabesh Gilead. And the men of Jabesh said unto Nahash, make a covenant with us, and we will serve thee. Surrender without a fight. They were wimping out. Now, they were surrounded. That's kind of a tough thing to be dealing with. And Ammon, of course, the son of Lot, born after Sodom and Gomorrah, and related to Israel, but often at war with Israel. And you can see the kingdom of Ammon there, right next to Jerusalem and all. And Nahash the Amorite answered them, on this condition will I make a covenant with you, that I may thrust out all of your right eyes and lay it for a reproach upon all of Israel. Now, he's going to poke out their eyes because this is what he did. History, you know, records that he wanted to make a point. And, you know, they're going to say, okay, yeah, you're going to go poke out our right eyes. And the elders of Jabesh said unto him, give us 7 days that we may send messengers unto all the coast of Israel. And then, if there be no man to save us, we will come out to thee. So, going to send messengers. They're surrounded. They're ready to surrender their right eyes. And then came the messengers of Gibeah of Saul and told the tidings in the ears of all the people. And the people lifted up their voices and wept. They're sad. They're angry. They're frustrated. Why? Because they haven't got a leader yet. And behold, Saul came out after the herd. Now, Saul was king. He'd been king for almost a year. And he was out plowing the fields. And Saul said, what aileth thee, the people that they weep? And they told him the tidings of Jabesh. King Saul was working the land. He was part of just farming. He was king. He'd been anointed. He'd been appointed. And the Spirit of God came upon Saul when he heard those tidings, and his anger was kindled greatly. Now, you know, we kind of act like anger in the face of sin is something we ought not to do, but maybe if the Spirit of God's involved, anger is the right response. And he took a yoke of oxen and hewed them in pieces and sent them throughout all the coast of Israel by the hand of messengers. Now, I couldn't find a yoke of oxen frequently, you know, nicely cut up, but this looks pretty good, and I kind of like steak, and it just, you know, awesome, you know. I need to go home and buy a ribeye, you know, on the way. There it is. Whosoever cometh not. Now, this is what he said. Whosoever comes not forth after Saul, after Samuel, so shall it be done unto his oxen. That'll be there chopped up, turned into hamburger. And the fear of the Lord fell upon the people, and they came out with one consent. When Saul said this, he sent out, you know, cuts of beef to everybody and said, this is what's going to happen to your animals if you don't show up to this battle. And when he numbered them, the children of Israel were 300,000 and the men of Judah 30,000. That's a lot of people. Now, Nahash had a problem now, okay? While he outnumbered Jabesh Gilead, he's probably a little outnumbered on his own. Now, I just wanted to give you a couple of comparisons. Alexander the Great conquered Persia and a whole bunch of other places all the way into India. And he had between 32,000 and 47,000. The difference was they were all trained soldiers. And 30,000 trained soldiers is probably better than 300,000 farmers. Hannibal's army at the Battle of Zama, number 20,000. Again, 20,000 battle-hardened soldiers, elephants, and Hannibal lost to the Romans. The Romans found out how to deal with elephants. Elephants don't like trumpets. And so, I think it was Scipio was the Roman general. He goes out there, he puts his trumpeters out front, he blasts into the ears of the elephants, they turn and trample over Hannibal's troops. End of story. Okay. Ramses II, 100,000 men. Now, I went to Exodus to talk about numbers for a minute. Because some people say, well, maybe the Bible, maybe that 300,000 wasn't a real number. Maybe, you know, I mean, it's a small area. But the children of Israel were fruitful and increased abundantly and multiplied and waxed exceedingly mighty, and the land was filled with them. Now, my point being is that the new king that rose up, the new Pharaoh, he's looking at a whole lot of people that he doesn't have control over. And he said, behold, the people, the children of Israel, are more and mightier than we. That's when he ordered the babies to be killed, wanted to have the boy babies killed so the women would intermarry and wipe out the Jewish race. Numbers in the Bible, if Ramses had 100,000 and the children of Israel filled the land, could Moses have led 2.5 million people into the wilderness? And the answer is pretty much yes. You know, why was Ramses worried about the number of children of Israel? Because there were so many of them. Alexander the Great, Ramses II, Hannibal, trained standing armies. Saul's 300 was every male 20 years old and up. Farmers, merchants, every man showed up, brought his, pitchfork and scythe, maybe a sword. Hey. And they said unto the messenger that came, that thus shall you say unto the men of Jabesh-Gilead, tomorrow. They sent a runner. They got 7 days before they get their eyes poked out, and they said, they sent a runner. Tomorrow we'll be there. And by the time the sun was hot, ye shall have help. And the messenger came and showed it to the men of Jabesh, and they were glad. I guess I'd be glad, too, if I was going to find out I wasn't going to get my eye poked out. I'm okay with that. Therefore, the men of Jabesh said, tomorrow we will come out unto you, and ye shall do unto us what seems good. Now, they're talking to Nahash. They're saying, okay, we're done. We'll come out to you tomorrow. They're lying, of course. But Nahash doesn't know there's an army coming to get him. And it was so on the morrow that Saul put the people in three companies, and they came into the midst of the host in the morning watch. That's about 9 o'clock in the morning. And they slew the Ammonites until the heat of the day. And it came to pass that they were reminded, the remained were scattered. And this is kind of interesting. It says that two of them were not left together. They chased these guys into the bushes. And they're running for their life. And they had no idea what was coming along. Good old Nahash was into him. And the people said unto Saul, who is he that said, Saul ran over us? Now, because a year ago, the people, there were a bunch of bad attitudes, okay? And they said, who is Saul that he's going to rule over us? Now, this is a different group in saying, who said that? We're going to get them. Bring them that we may put them to death. This is kind of euphoria after victory. They're all pumped up. They're all excited. They won the big battle. And now they're going to Now, what's interesting is that these guys who were saying, let's bring these guys out and kill them, weren't all that enthusiastic about serving Saul themselves. They just weren't guilty of saying it. Now, here's where Saul becomes the proper response of a humble king. And Saul said, there shall not one man be put to death this day, for today the Lord hath brought salvation in Israel. He said, we're not going to kill people. We've already killed the enemy. We've won the battle. God gave us the victory. We're going to rejoice in it. We're not going back. Then said Samuel to the people, come, let us go to Gilgal and renew the kingdom there. Now, what's interesting is that a year ago when Saul was made king, there were naysayers, there were people, there were skeptics, there were people who were off on the side, not really committed. And Samuel says, let's do this again. And all the people went to Gilgal, and there they made Saul king before the Lord in Gilgal. They reestablished Saul as the king. They accepted the naysayers that said, we don't want to serve him. The ambivalent who said, oh, well, you know, Saul can go back to farming. It was all now. And there they sacrifices of peace offerings before the Lord. And there Saul and all the men of Israel rejoiced greatly. Now, the peace offering was the barbecue offering. This was God got a little bit, hoof, hide, and hair, and the people got barbecue. So this is a special celebration. And everybody's happy. And Samuel said unto all Israel, behold, I have hearkened unto your voice and all that you said unto me, and have made a king over you. He's reinstating that he's made Samuel king. And now, behold, the king walks before you, and I am old and gray-headed. And behold, my sons are with you, and I have walked before you from my childhood unto this day. This is Samuel's retirement speech. Behold, here I am, witness against me before the Lord and before his anointed, whose ox I have taken or whose ass I have taken, whom I have defrauded, whom I have oppressed, or whose hand I have received any bribe to blind my eyes, and I will restore it to you. He's checking out, but he's saying, if you've got aught against me, now is the time. And they said, thou hast not defrauded us, nor oppressed us, neither hast thou taken aught of any man's hand. They are confirming that Samuel has been a faithful servant since his childhood. And he said unto them, the Lord is witness against you, and his anointed is witness this day, that ye have not found aught in my hand. And they answered, he is witness. Again, restating his faithfulness from childhood all the way through. And Samuel said unto the people, it is the Lord that advanced Moses and Aaron, and that brought your fathers up out of the land of Egypt. Now, therefore, stand still, that I may reason with you before the Lord of all the righteous acts which the Lord, which he did unto you and to your fathers. The 10 plagues of Egypt, bringing them across the Red Sea, all of that drama was God's hand on the children of Israel. And when Jacob was coming to Egypt and your fathers cried unto the Lord sent Moses and Aaron, which brought forth your fathers out of Egypt and made them dwell in this place. You know, we know Canaan land, land flowing with milk and honey. There's two things about milk and honey. You got to have cows to have milk, and you've got to have lots of flowering plants to have honey. So it was a rich and vital land, and God says, you're going to take their houses, their lands, their farms, you're going to move in, and it's going to be furnished and ready for you. All you've got to do is go in and kill those heathens. And when they fought, and when they forgot the Lord, he sold them into the hand of Caesarea, captain of the host of Hazar, and in the hands of the Philistines, and in the hands of King of Moab, and they fought against them. That when the children of Israel forgot God's mercy and God's provision, he sent enemies. And they cried unto the Lord and said, we have sinned because we have forsaken the Lord and have served Balaam and Ashtaroth. But now deliver us out of the hand of our enemies, and we will serve thee. Now there's Balaam and Ashtaroth. Balaam is the barbecue god where they took their babies alive and well and pitched them into the fire. That's a pretty serious thing. And the Lord sent Jerubbaal and Bedan and Jephthah and Samuel and delivered you out of the hands of your enemy on every side, and ye dwelled safely for about 20 years each. Gideon and his 300, Samson, all of that. They got 20 years, and then they went back to serving the gods. And when you saw that Nahash, the king of the children of Ammon, came against you, and you said unto me, but a king shall reign over us, when the Lord God was your king. The history books talk about Nahash. This was his regular practice. He would surround a village, give them the opportunity to surrender, give them a few days to find support, poke out their eyes, and set up their taxes. That's what he did. Now, therefore, behold, the king whom you have chosen and whom you have desired, and behold, the Lord has set a king over you. Now, what's interesting is that God anointed Saul as king. And, you know, the kings of France and the kings of England and the kings of everything else decided they were anointed by God, too, and had just as much power. Didn't work forever, but it was successful for a while. If you will fear the Lord and serve him and obey his voice, fear the Lord, serve him, obey, and not rebel against the commandments of the Lord, then shall both ye and also the king that reigns over you continue following the Lord your God. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. Fear the Lord. Why? Well, because he's the judge. He's the end. He's where we all get to stand. Okay. But if you will not obey the voice of the Lord, but rebel against the commandments of the Lord, then shall the hand of the Lord be against you as it was against your fathers. You know, God says, thou shalt have no other gods before me. But they've slid in Balaam and Ashtaroth because it was popular, because it was the thing to do. It's because what everybody else was doing all around them. Now therefore stand and see this great thing which the Lord will do before your eyes. That God has a promise, obey me and prosper. Is it not wheat harvest today? I will call unto the Lord, and he shall send thunder and rain. Now, why? Because normally in the wheat harvest, it was dry. That's why it was wheat harvest, because it had grown up, the rain stopped, it was ready to harvest. And you don't want thunder, lightning, and rain before you've harvested the wheat. And he says, I'm going to bring something you don't expect. Why? Because it never rains in this time of year. That you may perceive and see that your wickedness is great, which you have done in the sight of the Lord in asking for a king. He's saying, okay, it was uncommon to have rain at this time. The wheat gets beaten down, and it's much harder to harvest. So Samuel called unto the Lord, and the Lord sent thunder and rain that day, and all the people greatly feared the Lord and Samuel. He had done something that shouldn't happen. You know, we live in California. You might get a little rain in August, but from somewhere in April or May to sometime in October, it doesn't rain here. That's the way it is. And all the people said unto Samuel, pray for thy servants unto the Lord thy God that we die not. Okay? They're kind of getting serious here. That we die not, for we have added unto all the sins this evil to ask of a king. Now, it's too late. They've already got a king. They've anointed him. But they realize it was there. And Samuel said unto the people, fear not. For ye have done all this wickedness, yet turn not aside from following the Lord, but serve the Lord with all your heart. That yes, you've sinned. Your father sinned, your grandfather, everybody sinned. God punished you. But don't worry about it. Serve God. Wholeheartedly, completely, sincerely, devoted, determined, enthusiastic, because I want to. You know, why do we come to church? Because we want to? Yeah. Or because we have to, okay? Half-hearted, lacking spirit or interest, because I have to. How do we serve the Lord? Wholeheartedly? Are we here because we want to be here or because we have to be here? And turn not aside for them that ye should go after vain things which cannot profit nor deliver, for they are vain. And I don't remember what these pigeons are about. I can't read it, so what's going on? It was a great little graphic, but I, you know, it didn't come across. Okay. For the Lord will not forsake his people for his great name's sake, because it hath pleased the Lord to make you his people. Now, Reptevia from Fiddler on the Roof, he says, but once in a while, can't you choose someone else? You know, that was it. Moreover, as for me, God forbid that I should sin against the Lord in ceasing to pray for you. Samuel is saying, I will continue to pray for you, but I will teach you the good and the right way. Follow the Lord. Obey God. Only fear the Lord and serve him in truth with all your heart, for consider how great things he hath done. What great God. He brought them out of Egypt. He gave them the land flowing with milk and honey. He saved them from their own wickedness time after time after time. And he says, I'm going to keep doing it. But if ye shall still do wickedly, ye shall be consumed, both ye and your king. The human cost of turning away from God, and later in chapters we'll find out how that cost the kingdom and how that cost King Saul. Saul reigned 1 year, and when he had reigned 2 years over Israel, now when it says reigned, he's not farming anymore. He's out there ruling. He's out there in the mix. Saul chose him 3,000 men of Israel, whereof 2,000 men were with Saul in Michmash and Mount Bethel, and 1,000 were with Jonathan, Gibeah, and Benjamin, and the rest of the people he sent every man to his tent. This is what Samuel said, I'm going to choose the best of your best. I'm going to take your best men. They're going to be with me. Instead of farming your fields, they're going to be farming my fields. This is Michmash. This is a country set for battle. It's a hill country, and, you know, it's not a flat plain. It's not a happy place. It's not an easy. It's a bad place for an ambush. Well, we're going to get down to, for all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. Good things about Samuel, but the best things about Jesus. For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. But God commanded his own love towards us, and that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. For everyone who calls upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. And you know, it's interesting because you can't call upon the name of the Lord unless the Lord is calling you. If you declare with your mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart that God hath raised him from the dead, ye shall be saved. And with that, please stand. We're going to pray. God, we ask you to bless again this week, your word to these, your people, that we would carry your words with us and be a witness in our communities, in our lives, and with the people we encounter. And we ask your blessing in Jesus' name. Amen.